I have the great pleasure of introducing Carly Findlay. Come on up, Carly. She writes on disability issues for publications including ABC, Daily Life and SBS. She was named as one of Australia's most influential women in the 2014 Australian Financial Review and Westpac 100 Women of Influence Awards. And she recently appeared on an absolutely fantastic episode of ABC's You Can't Ask That. Welcome, Carly.
I'd like to recognise the Aboriginal elders, past, present and future. I'd also like to acknowledge disability activists who have and are still paving the way for it today. This speech contains ableist language used as examples only. How to be a good non-disabled feminist. A couple of months ago, I was removed from a Facebook group for being too political about my disability. I'd answered a question from one of the group's founders. Should their daughter make a dramatic change to her hair? That's a huge part of her identity. My answer, of course, was based on my personal experience. It was polite, encouraging, and empathetic. I said that as someone with a disability and a visible difference, I'm always so proud when a young person chooses to make themselves stand out in some way. I told her that telling someone that they might regret changing their appearance or looking different from their peers is limiting to her daughter and to others. I added that long hair is often the mark of a feminine woman and thought back to when I planned my wedding and I didn't see any photos of short hair rise on Pinterest. I ended my comment with how my scalp is and was very patchy and I was often really self-conscious. A week after that post, I noticed I was removed from the group. I was unfriended by the founder. I questioned them, and they said to me they don't think this group is for me, that I was too political about my disability and that made people uncomfortable. My voice, a disabled viewpoint, was shut down. The Facebook group is run by women. It's for women. Just like me, these women love champagne, they love fashion, and they occasionally complain about our husbands not picking up the slack around the house. Many of us want to do good in the world, improving life for future generations. Some of the group founders, they went to the women's marches. They wore their pussy hats. They called themselves feminists. But they excluded a disabled voice from the discussion. I wondered whether the other women were removed, the ones that agreed with me. They're white, middle class, Jewish, married, mothers, heterosexual, black, gay. No, they're still in the group. This might just seem like a small social media spat, a minor fallout between two women, but to me it symbolises more. This microaggression, something that happens to me every day. It reminded me that this exclusion of disabled people still happens. We're excluded from employment, from buildings, we're placed in group homes and segregated schools. Some disabled people are paid a measly $2.79 an hour in Australian disability enterprises. We're excluded from female relationships because our disability politics and pride is too confronting. We're excluded from feminism. Here's another example. A couple of days before the Sydney-Melbourne Women's Marches in January, I was contacted by two different organisers asking how to make the march more accessible. They didn't think to organise it before, they didn't think to get disabled speakers. They said they've reached out, but accessibility and inclusion was an afterthought. And disability was left off the women's marches around the world. Accessibility was hard to come by. American disability activist Emily Liddell wrote for the establishment in January, but I shouldn't have to be explaining this, especially not to people who deem themselves leaders in social justice. These examples show yet again that disability is the forgotten part of diversity. So here's what I want to tell the non-disabled feminist. Disability is part of my identity. It's not a bad thing. It's just like gender, race, sexuality, and religion and colour. It cannot be separated. I'm a proud disabled woman and I will speak about it. I will make you uncomfortable with politics and pride. The personal is political. You will not silence this part of my identity. You can't be a good feminist if you're not intersectional. This means you must include, listen to, and value people with disability in your conversations, policies, writings, conferences, and protests. It hurts when we're excluded, even from Facebook groups. Progressive, inclusive, and diverse people still use ableist slurs. I've seen prominent activists from marginalised communities use the R word and derivatives of, and not realise the impact. I've called them on this. The way people are talking about Donald Trump right now, calling him a moron, mocking his speech, and diagnosing him with a mental illness or intellectual disability, that's ableism. It suggests that people with those impairments are like him. It paints disabled people as less than. You cannot fight discrimination with discrimination. Don't make disability and accessibility an afterthought. Make sure we're on your panels and behind the megaphones of your marches. Plan and budget for accessible events from the start. It will keep the cost down and your disabled attendees will not be exasperated having to chase this up. Pay us. Pay us to provide lived experience and advice. Last week I experienced yet another refusal of payment for me to talk at an event. Their reason floored me. I was told by a disability worker at a disability support organisation that they couldn't justify my fee because the disabled people they worked with did not have the intellectual capacity to understand the formal speech. The low expectations that this work had of their disabled clients was disgusting. Invite us to be involved in the media. Centre our voices. If you're writing a story on disabled people, don't forget to talk to us. Ask us on Human Day, the project, the Trump, Insight. Didn't Karuna Stanwell do an amazing job talking about the NDIS on Monday night? Nothing about us without us. Don't expect us to answer every question about our disability to satisfy your curiosity. From being asked how long my life expectancy is and whether I can fix my face with strangers, to being told the false likelihood of me passing on my condition to my future children by my mother-in-law, you name it, I've been asked an inappropriate question. Include statistics about people with disability when talking about and preventing violence. Disabled person people's Organisations Australia states that people with disability experience higher rates of violence than the rest of the community. 90% of women with intellectual disability have been sexually assaulted in their lives, and 60% before they're 18. Children with disability are 3 times more likely to experience abuse than other children, and 45% of people with disability live on or below the poverty line. To end, I'm not asking you to forget the array of important issues that you campaign for, but to remember us and remember our issues with your activism. You support Black Lives Matter. You champion marriage equality. You want fair pay for fair work. You want to close the refugee camps. You're calling for a halt to climate change. You want violence against women to stop. You attend the women's marches. You wear your pussy hats, and so do I. Do not forget to include, to listen to, and value your disabled sisters in your feminist movement, or you're not a good, a non-disabled feminist. Thank you.
Thanks, Carly.
Thank you.
That's amazing. So, can I ask you a question?
Mm-hmm.
Just ignore everybody in the audience that is not an anti-ableist activist and speak directly to them and tell them how you managed to get up and do something really brave that means that you're going to get excluded from places, that you have to stand up for who you are. How do you get yourself in a position where you can do that and keep yourself okay?
I just do it. I've got no excuse or no choice, rather, not to disclose my disability.
Yes.
So every time I meet someone new, they're thinking, why, what's wrong with you? Why do you look the way you do?
possibly that I can't speak for myself.
Yeah.
And I just have to do it. I don't claim to speak for everyone with a disability because I don't have their lived experience, but I do hope that I can give a voice to the issues like I've raised today. But it can get tiring. I was at a concert a couple of months ago, and a lady in front of me just laughed at my face, laughed at me. And when I said, this isn't appropriate, like you just laugh at a stranger's face. Her friend, she couldn't speak, she was gobsmacked that I couldn't even speak to her, I guess. But her friend said, well, she hasn't seen anyone like you before, so of course she's laughing. Yeah, I wrote about it.
That's your power.
Yeah. And actually, I tapped on the shoulder at the end of the concert and I said, hey, I was the woman whose face you laughed at. She still couldn't talk to me. And then they said, oh no, you got it wrong. That's the thing, like, every time I try to raise these issues, it's always that I'm taking it too seriously.
Yeah, the strategies of microaggression.
Mm. Yeah.
And what do you hope to see? Like, what's the vision that you want to see in the next 20 years? Where do you think we can get to? In the room.
I'd like that people with disability do not have to explain our medical history to strangers, that we are represented fairly and equally in the media. I don't want to see, like you mentioned, these Daily Telegraph Herald's front pages had slackers and slouch hats and $17 billion debt by disabled people. I don't want to see any of that, you know. But nor do I want to see the inspiration porn as Estella Young has talked about.
Thank you.
That's right. Thank you.
Thanks, Matt.